Daniel chapter 1 from verse 3 to 4. I'm saying verses first because most times when we hear about the name of Daniel or the book of Daniel, the first thing that comes to us is Daniel in the lion's den. But we'll move beyond the lion's den this morning. So I'll read the first few verses. Then the king instructed Aspinas, the master of his eunuchs, to bring some of the children of Israel, and some of the king's descendants, and some of the nobles, young men in whom there was no blemish, but good looking, gifted in all wisdom, possessing knowledge, quick to understand, and who had the ability to serve in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the language and literature of the Chaldeans. I'll take the last part again. And whom they might teach the language and literature of the Chaldeans. Now, if you look at these two verses, these were smart men. These were uber men, as we'll see. These were men that they had street sense, they were very wise, and they had a lot of them. But yet, in that last part, they said that whom they might teach the language and the literature of the Chaldeans. And I'm going somewhere. The language you may understand, but the literature now brings me to where I'm going this morning. Because if we look at the kingdom of the Lord, there are so many things that the Lord is always sharing with us in various forms. Sometimes someone comes to stand before us and they share from one verse of the Bible for 30 minutes. The next Sunday, somebody else comes to share from that same verse for 30 minutes and they are saying, giving us different interpretations. That is how powerful the word of the Lord is, and that is how powerful the kingdom principles of our God is. But there is one important thing we'll see about kings those days, and I'll try to relate it to us today. When you see kings, what are the kind of people they want around them? This is what it is telling us. They want them to speak the same language. They want them to have the same knowledge that they have. They want them to, you know, the same literature that they have, as you said. And one thing that is very, very important, most times they like people that have the same personality. And I'd like to still relate this to us. Sometimes, some of us have drivers, and some of us are drivers in the house. And some of us, we may have our spouse driving us, or people that are close driving us. And I'm talking about driving a car. And one thing about having a driver is, even if you hire a driver that has been driving for 20 years, the day he starts to drive you, there is no way you will not correct him. He's either driving too fast, or he's driving too slow. That guy doesn't put the AC on time, or he uses the horn a lot. Can anyone get you that in the house? And if you're a driver in the house, and you have been driving a car for 20 years, or 10 years, and by chance you have to change jobs, the first day you drive the new boss, or the new person, or your new client, or your new customer, what's the first thing that happens? They would always have something to what? To say. And if they don't have something to say, even you yourself, you'll be scared that are able to fire me in 2 days' time. And the same thing comes when some of us get employed in some large corporations. What is the first thing they do? They want to teach you the values. They want to teach you the customs. They want to teach you the norms and the principles from the onset. And I'm going to start this service, or this sermon, by saying that it's the same way the Lord wants us to walk with him in a deeper level. And I'll break it down a bit. If a lot of us have been following what the Lord has been saying to the churches in the last couple of weeks, he's been talking about the Holy Spirit. And if we break it down home, the Lord has been teaching us about the Holy Spirit as well in the last couple of weeks. And I would like us to go to the Genesis, or to the book of Genesis, and the Genesis of this. So we see some of the principles that God had in mind when he was creating man. I've always learned to go to the original intent of God for certain areas or certain things he's showing you. So if you go into the book of Genesis chapter 1 from verse 26, Genesis chapter 1 from verse 26, before they get to 26, every time we see what the Lord has done in the Bible, we always hear or see or read of let thee. But when it was time to create man, God said, let us make man in our own image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image, and in the image of God he created them, male and female he created them. Let us make man in our own image. So first of all, I'd like to remind us this morning about this word image. Because most times when we read this, the first thing that comes to mind is that for some of us, maybe not all of us, is that God does have the shape of a man, just like you and I. That is, he's making us in his own image. But we also know that when Jesus met the Samaritan woman in John chapter 4, verse 24, he said, God is what? Spirit. And those who worship him must worship him in spirit and what? In truth. So we can picture this image of God as being the Spirit of God. Because the Bible also tells us several times that there is a spirit in man. And most times, what we fail to realize is that when God is communicating to us, it is through the Spirit. If you look at one of the first ways, when we look at when people walk with God, that's the first examples in the Bible. We look at the story of Adam and Eve, and when they sinned, and they were hiding somewhere, and he said that they were hiding, and they heard the sound of the Lord. And after that, God started talking to them. Maybe we should look at that. I think it's in the book of Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3 from verse 8. Yes, verse 8. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, where are you? So he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. So they heard his voice, they knew he was there, they probably didn't see a physical image. Some versions of the Bible would not say in the cool of the day, they would say there was a wind. And we know that when God was going to appear to Elijah and to Job, he appeared in the form of a wind. And sometimes we have some of these representations of the Holy Spirit as well. Sometimes it will appear to us as fire, some of us like it. The fire of the Lord, the Holy Spirit was moving and there was fire, right? Sometimes we say that, no, there was anointing and oil was just overflowing. And sometimes we say, oh, there was just this breeze that was blowing. And we say that was the Spirit of the Lord. But this morning, I'd like to title the word the Lord is sending to us this morning. Because it is not about the title of the sermon. It is about what he is saying and should remind us of this morning, which is called the inner voice. The inner voice. And this inner voice, a lot of us hear it. But most times, things always become it, things surround it, things choke it. And it is in God's original intention that this voice follows us all through the day, all through the week, all through the year, all through whatever circumstances we may find ourselves in life. That was his original intention. And that was one of the reasons why he said, let us make man in our own image. So that when the Spirit is speaking to the Spirit, then we have that divine connection. And we can run in the purposes and the will of the Lord. But most times, when we hear about the Holy Spirit, He seems distant to us. We think of a deity. We think of some force somewhere. And we don't relate to the Holy Spirit as that helper, as that guide, or that counselor that the Lord has sent unto us. And we go a bit deeper. And as I'm going deeper, you forgive me because I'll try to break down some things. This week, in our nation, a lot of things happen. Ministers are appointed, special advisors, commissioners, at least in our state and in our nation. And we give God the glory for the members of the house that got some positions as well. We thank God for that. Can we give a clap of hands to the Lord? And what will happen in the next couple of months, or in the next 2 or 3 years, is that when we want to complain about something, when we have some grievances, when we feel some things are not being done the right way, what do? We start calling the name of the president, right? We say the president is not doing this, he's not doing that. But yet, he has appointed people to speak for him in various areas. So what is the first thing he's going to do? He's going to call those people together, and he's going to show to them the vision he has. Even if he doesn't have any, he's still going to tell them, go and do this. Because he has to tell them something. And based on that, everybody will what? They will run. Whether they are running in the right direction or not, they will what? They will run. And when it comes to us, the children of God, there are so many things that the Lord has destined for us to achieve. So many roads He has showed us that we have to get on. So many paths that He has said, this is a path to your destiny. And yet, when we look at it, those things seem so big. Sometimes they seem vague. Sometimes they seem impossible to achieve. And He's saying, I have sent you my prime minister. I have sent you your special advisor. I have sent you your governor. And that is your Holy Spirit. That is the kingdom principle. That is our kingdom principle. And if you don't learn to walk or run in that kingdom principle, there are so many things that we tend to miss. Because most times we focus on the gift and not the giver of the gift. So I give an example. If people start falling now under the anointing, what is the first thing we will say? The Holy Spirit is what? Is moving. But we don't take time to say, we know you are moving, but what are you saying? And He's speaking to each and every one of us. It's the same way when you get on the radio and you turn on the radio and if it's random, you start tuning to a station. The moment you tune into that station, you tune in and you listen to what is being said in that station. You have an option to tune out of that station and look for another station. But when you know that there is something you want to hear, or there is a particular piece of information you need to receive, and that is going to come up at 11 o'clock, at 11 o'clock you tune into that station. Isn't that so? And that is the same way the Lord wants us to run with Him this morning. He wants us to tune in all the time. Because He is the radio station that never shuts down. He is the one whose frequency is always right. And He is always speaking and He is always walking. And He is waiting for His children to join Him in that race. And this is so important. This is very, very important. Because if you look at the life of Jesus, everything is always about Jesus. One of the first steps he took before he started his public ministry was the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It was symbolic that it seemed like he was being baptized in water, but it was the baptism of the Holy Spirit that was happening. Because he knew that the original plan of God was let us make man. And I stand on the views of people that have said the us was God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. So he knew at every point in time that this is the ministry that the Lord has given him. And at every point in time, he needed to rely on the Holy Spirit for that ministry. And the Lord is saying to us this morning that there are so many things that we are doing, but yet we tend to rely on what we see. We tend to rely on what we hear. We tend to rely on our intellect. And it is not to condemn us, because there is a time when the human part of us, the flesh part of us, starts to operate. And every day, we need to keep crucifying the flesh and let the Spirit of the Lord have his way in our lives and in every single thing that concerns us. And I'd like us to look at the book of John, chapter 16, verse 7 and verses 13 to 15. Book of John, chapter 7. John chapter 16. John chapter 16 will start from verse 7. Okay, so just going to verse 7. It says, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you." Again, the Helper will not come to you. The disciples were used to Jesus being around them. And if we're in their shoes, we will do the same thing. I mean, they were seeing him just every day next to them. And he was more or less doing all the work. Everybody was calling upon his name. Everybody was running to him. And yet, he was telling them that, "Look, I'm going. But you guys have to continue this race. You guys have to continue this work." And he was not just telling them he will send the Holy Spirit, but he was calling the Holy Spirit what? The Helper. Because he knows at that point in time, when they need to hear his voice or his instruction, the voice of the Holy Spirit will be there to help them. I don't know who is in the house today, but I'm saying to you and I'm reminding you that the Holy Spirit is still there and is still speaking. And he's still there to point you back to the right direction and the right step to take. And there are so many things that are in store for you that the Holy Spirit will start to lead you towards those areas. Still moving on. The same way, we will also see something very, very important and symbolic that Jesus did. Still in the same book of John, chapter 20. From verse 21 to 22. John chapter 20, from verse 21 to 22. So Jesus said to them again, this was after he appeared to them after the resurrection. He said, "Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." Verse 22. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Receive the Holy Spirit. The ultimate kingdom goal of Jesus was this: receive the Holy Spirit. It was beyond the healing. It was beyond the miracles. It was beyond all the things that he did. Receive the Holy Spirit. Because at that point, he knew that once you receive the Holy Spirit, there is nothing you cannot accomplish. Be it in the ministry of the word, or in whatever you find your hands doing. And God is always speaking to us through the Holy Spirit. Every time, he's always speaking to us through the Holy Spirit. It may be difficult for us sometimes to hear this voice. And it's okay. There are times when we are not even used to hearing the voice. And what do we do we go back to that place where we last heard the voice, or where we think we can catch this voice again. And I like to use two examples in the Bible. Again, let's look at the book of the Bible. Let's look at Elijah's story in the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings, I believe that should be chapter 18. And I will just pick some parts of this story. This has to do with when Elijah was able to not just defeat the prophets of Baal, but he killed all of them, which was what was supposed to be the victor's crown. So 1 Kings chapter 18, and if you start from verse 24, it says, "Call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord, and the God who answers by fire, he is God." That was the first point. He had acknowledged who God is. And verse 27, "When it was known, he mocked them and said, 'Cry aloud, for he is a God.'" He was talking about their God. "Either he's meditating, or he's busy, or he's on a journey, or perhaps he's sleeping and must be awakened. He is still making fun of their God." Then Elijah said to all the people, "Come near to me." And the first thing he did, he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. May the Lord give us the grace to repair some of our broken altars this morning in Jesus' name. Because Elijah knew that the first thing he had to do was to go back to that place and to show people they had to go back to that place where they knew that they could meet and interact and hear from the Lord. Verse 36, or let me go to verse 38. "Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice, and the wood, and the stones, and the dust. And it licked up the water that was in the trench. Now when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, 'The Lord is God. The Lord is God.' And Elijah said to them, 'Seize the prophets of Baal. Do not let one of them escape.' So they seized them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and executed them there." Such a powerful work that the Lord had done. Wonderful that the Lord had done through Elijah. And something happened if you go to verse 19. Not long after that, "And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and how he had executed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, 'Let the gods do to me and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time.' And when he saw that, he arose and ran for his life." He arose and ran for his life. This is someone that made fun of the gods a few hours or a day before. This is someone that made a mockery of these same gods. And then all of a sudden, someone comes to threaten him in the name of those same gods. And what is the first thing he does? He runs away. He takes to flight. He has built an altar. He didn't run to the altar that he built. He ran away. He had so many people that have been executed in his presence. What did he do? He ran away. And for a lot of us, there are so many things that the Lord has placed before us. And when we look at it, when we see the magnitude, what is the first thing we do? We run to a place of comfort. We run to a place of safety. And the same God that is saying, "I have placed this before you, I have put this in your eyes," he's saying, "I'm not leaving you alone. I'm sending the helper. I'm sending the Holy Spirit." And the Holy Spirit will continue to speak. You continue to guide him. And we look at the story of Eli and Samuel. We know that at that time, there were so many interpretations of what had happened to Eli. But there was one thing he knew, that when Samuel ran to him the first time, Samuel ran to him the second time. What did he say the third time? says, stay there and say, speak, Lord, for your servant is what? Is listening. And when the Lord told Samuel what he was going to do in the house of Eli, even Samuel was afraid to tell Eli. And that is because when the Lord reveals things to you, it is usually bigger than your mind can conceive. But that is the kind of promise he gives us. It is usually beyond your capacity. So if you are someone who is used to running 100 meters, and you've won so many gold medals in 100 meters, and the challenge of 100 meters come, that is when the Lord is telling you it is time for you to move from 100 meters to 400 meters. And he's not saying, I was not between 100 meters. He's saying, I was with you when you're running 100 meters, and I will be with you to achieve that same victory when you have to run 400 meters. And that is how the Lord works with us. God is always speaking. He speaks to us all the time through the Holy Spirit. The challenge with us most times is we cannot relate with the Holy Spirit as someone who speaks with us. And I'm saying someone because when Jesus wants to describe the Holy Spirit, he will say he will be with you, he will comfort you, he will guide you. So he gave us the companion, he gave us the helper, he gave us the advisor. But yet, what do we do most times? We look all around us and we start picking the things around us, and based on that, we use it in making life decisions. And what happens when we make life decisions is we get life results. So if people look at you and they tell you you can never accomplish something, if that is the voice that you have, then you limit yourself to the way man sees you. But if you remember that the word of the Lord says that with God all things are possible, and the moment the Holy Spirit reveals that to you and you start to speak that voice, that word over that situation, then so shall it be, because you are walking in accordance with the will of God. But when we look at it and this is far from us, what happens is we end up having what? Life's results. And life results always give us the hardships that comes with life. There are so many words that we hear every day. But before I go into that, I would not like to go into probably the last word I'll read to you. That's Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, from verse 13. Matthew chapter 16, from verse 13. And it says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? So they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered and said, you are Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven as you build this to Peter. And I will end with this. The others had seen so many things. They had seen Jesus, as it is stated here, as John the Baptist. The same Elijah that we shared about, they saw him as Elijah. Because that was what their mind could conceive. But the moment Peter made that declaration, he knew that this was not what he could conceive with his own imagination. And I love Peter. Because most times, we make fun of him when we read the things he did in the Bible. But there was one thing about him. He may have had many faith, but he had some kind of faith. He may have had little faith, but he had some kind of faith. And with that faith, every time he took a little step, the Lord was always there to magnify those steps. And the Lord is saying to us this morning, it is time for us to start taking those little steps. I'd like us to just rise up and go into a time of prayer.
Thank you for watching today's sermon. Subscribe now to get an update on when the latest sermon arrives.